A little woman is sitting present now. She has been at this altar time after time after time. A good woman. But she started smoking a long time ago. And she just couldn't overcome it. And she'd come up and I would pray with her. And seemed like she just couldn't overcome it. And the first thing you know, I told her here, I said, there will be danger down the road. She said, oh, Brother Branham, I have cried, I have begged. You see, just the emotional fight in the air, that won't do any good. And I'd get down and pray with her, lay hands on her, and she'd go back. And a few days I'd meet her again, just knock you down with cigarette smoke, hands still brown. And one night down yonder, she went to a doctor, began to get sick and wither away to just a little spindly thing. And the doctor looked into her and he said, cancer, smoking cigarettes. There she was laying there to die. Then she got down to business. See, a drowning man will reach for a straw. Long as you can walk out of this church tonight, know you can go join the Methodist or Baptist. As long as you can sit in here and say, now, I'm a good person. There's nothing wrong with me. You can't do nothing with you. That's right. But when you see your sins as God sees them in the light of His Bible, when you see you'll repent or perish, something will take place. You get to business. Walk out of here and a smothering around your heart. The doctor back there will maybe raise up, come up, looks, it's a heart attack. You get to business. Amen. That's when she had to get to business. And the woman's sitting looking at me now. And Brother Roberson's back there, and Mr. Woods here, Brother Woods sitting here somewhere. And I were going down hunting, I believe, somewhere in the truck. And the Holy Spirit seemed to move us to go way up through the knobs to where she was. And when I got there, she had had a dream. And when the Holy Spirit came into the room and she got down to real business, she never smoked a cigarette from then on. And she's gained many pounds of weight. And they can't find a trace of the cancer. What is it? It's faith that overcomes.
Amen.
Why didn't it overcome when I was praying for her here? She's just fluttering around. But when the doctor says you got cancer and going to die, she got to business. That's the way it has to get. When you get to business, why wait that long? Why not get down to business now?
Amen.
Put your faith in God. Well, if a woman had her faith in me, it had failed, because I'm a man. But when she changed her faith, not in the Branham Tabernacle, or in William Branham, or in anyone else, but placed her faith in Jesus Christ, then she got faith. She raised up above all the fears and doubts, and God healed her. God wants to mold and make us what He wants us to be. But how can we do that, or how can God do that, when we won't even stand still for Him to do it? We want to be our own master. We want to think our own way of thinking. And many people come into the church and join the church and put their name on the book and doesn't even consider what that church believes. Or check up with that church how they preach the Word of God. Or whether they stand for the full gospel or not. Or just pick out a potion and add a creed. Floating, drifting, never be able to mount to anything. But let me tell you something tonight, you on the in and outside of this building. You're going to wind up at a destination one of these days. That's going to be in the valley of the shadows of death. I would advise you at this hour to prepare to meet the God that will have to meet you at that hour. You'll either meet Him as a masterpiece that He has worked on, or a floating piece of driftwood to go into your final destination. So don't you use this life just to drift around and float around and get a better job and to dress better and to get a new television or a better car. Life means more than that. Don't you try to use it just to say, well, if the rest of them join church, I will too. When you join church, you should first seek out and find out what that church stands for. Is it just merely a place that the people go together for fellowship? Or is it a place that preaches the Word of the living God and stands for every principle that Jesus died for? You should do that. Just don't float in and go with the tide. Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth to life. And but few there'll be that'll go in thereat. Because broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many will there be go in. We've got to have a purpose of something. Now, it wasn't so in days gone by or in this day that when a man come to God, he had a purpose of doing it. If your purpose is just to drift at that congregation, or is it to look up toward God? Daniel, when he was taken down into Babylon, though he was going away from his home, and he was going to have to be a slave to another nation of people, but Daniel purposed in his heart, no matter what they did to him, he wasn't going to defile himself with the Babylonian sin. Oh, if we had more gallant men like that, that would purpose in your heart. If I am a Christian, I'm going to find out every divine blessing that belongs to me and claim it. If the Bible teaches that I can receive the Holy Spirit, I'm going to stay on my knees till God gives me the Holy Spirit. And just not drift. I was reading old Uncle Buddy Robinson's life story some time ago. And he was such a great man, and a loving man, and a man of faith. And he got the hungering for the Holy Spirit because the Bible taught it. And it says that one day he was plowing corn, and he stopped his old mule, Elick, got down in the corn row and said, God, if you don't give me the baptism of the Holy Spirit, when you come back to earth, you'll find my bones laying right here. That's purposing in your heart. That's really getting to business. When you get that kind of a purpose in your heart, God's going to open the windows of heaven. Something has to take place. You've got to get to business with God.
Amen.
And have some purpose and some gratitude for Him saving you. And when Daniel had purposed in his heart, and the devil made him prove it, but we find out that it stood good in the face of a hungry lion.
Amen.
And a man that ever comes to God and really down in his heart finds a settled faith. It'll stand good in the mouth of death or in the mouth of sickness, in the mouth of sorrow. It'll stand good. For faith is the victory. You have overcome by your faith. Many of you people have faith in your doctors. And you should have if you've got a doctor. And now when something gets wrong with you, you'll go to that old faithful doctor that you believe in. That's what you should do. That's good. And then you submit your case to him. If he says you should go to the hospital, you don't do a thing but go home and pack up your clothes and take off to the hospital. Sure. You got faith in the doctor. And if he doesn't decide that you want to go to the hospital, or you should go rather, he'll write out a prescription and give you a sack full of pills. And you'll swallow them. And you don't know what's in those pills. But you got faith in your doctor. How about God? And you're scared to swallow some of the gospels that he gives you.
Amen.
By his stripes you were healed.
Hallelujah.
Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Swallow it and see what happens.
Amen.
It's a confidence. You show what confidence you have in your doctor by taking his medicine that you don't know what it is. You show your confidence in the doctor by submitting yourself to an operation that proves your confidence in the doctor. But when it comes to Christ, you're scared to take him at his word. How is it? Faith is the victory.
Amen.
If you could submit your case to Jesus Christ tonight, just as you submit your case to the doctor. Give me anything you want to, Lord.
Amen.
You're the doctor on the case.
Amen.
Then you've got the victory.
Amen.
Then you've got faith that overcomes. Another hunt, another prayer line. You'll never hunt nothing else. You'll have it right there. It'll be all settled. You'll never jump from church to church to see if this one's got it or that one's got it. They haven't got it. You've got it then. When you've got the faith, you have the victory. I'll tell you what we need tonight in America, and what we need tonight here in this tabernacle, is to let Dr. Jesus come in and perform an operation on our faith.
Amen.
The doctor tells you you got a little appendix, it's all poison, it ought to come out. You got this, that, or the other, it's wrong, it's got to come out. Well, he takes it out so the rest of it can function right. And what's the matter tonight with our faith? We're afraid to let God take his operating word, his knife, sharper than a two-edged sword, and operate on us and tell us that our little fang-dangle humbugging around is wrong and we've got to turn loose every shutter and sail towards God's eternal promise. Oh, if we'll do that, Jesus will perform an operation upon our faith, taking away all the doubt, all the fears, and all the weary, all the sin, everything there is. And then when our faith is clearly operated on, we come out a new creature. We're a different man. We need an operation. Can you trust Jesus Christ for that operation? Can you believe in him? Can you say, Lord God, at thy word? At thy word, as the disciples said in St. Mark 5, when they said, we stained all night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, Lord, at thy word, I'll let down the net, said Peter. Lord, I am a fisherman. I know the signs when the moon's just right. I know when they're biting and when they're not. I know when they're in their schools and when they're not. Not only that, but I've seined all night, and here is a council of doctors here with me, Dr. Fisherman's. And we know our trade. And we've searched this stream all night long and haven't taken nothing. But at thy word, Lord, I'll let down the net. Because of the chief surgeon said so. The chief doctor said so. And they enclose such a multitude of fishes till their nets begin to break. Why? Faith is the victory. There might not have even been one fish in the water. But when God has made a promise, He'll create fish and put them there. There may not be a chance for you to live. You may be dying with cancer. You may be bound to a wheelchair. You may be totally blind. I don't know what your trouble is. But if you'll take the chief doctor's prescription, whatsoever thing you desire, when you pray, believe you receive it, and you shall have it, and believe that that faith will overcome any difficulty that there is. You may be so burdened with sin until your soul is as smutty as it can be. You may have tried to get rid of that ill temper, that slandering tongue, that gossip on the telephone. You might have tried every remedy you know how. But if you'll just let Jesus Christ come into you tonight, He'll operate on your faith and give you a faith that'll climb beyond anything that the world can produce. Why? Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. How could you doubt? When Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, His presence here now, His great Holy Spirit in this building, the Word promised that, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. It was promised by the Lord. God has to keep His Word. Do you believe that? When He promised He'd do these things, God is solemnly obligated to do such. Now, I want you to think it over. If you have sin, if there's anything wrong in your life, I want you to think it over while we bow our heads just a moment for prayer. Before we pray, I'd like to ask this question. I'd like to ask if there is a man, woman, boy, or girl that's in this building that would say by an uplifted hand, Lord, I just seemingly can't overcome. It seems like I know that I shouldn't do these things. I know I shouldn't do this and that. But I want you to operate on my faith right now after this message. I want you to give me a complete checking over. And operate on the ever little disease of my faith that would keep me from overcoming these things. Hold up your hand to Him, will you do it? The Lord bless you. Place just full of hands. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us. And run with patience this race that's been set before us. Looking to the author and finisher of our faith, the Lord Jesus Christ. How many in here that's sick and needy would raise up your hand and say, Lord, operate on my faith. I have need tonight, Lord. God bless you. Faith is the victory. How do we get faith? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the Word of God. Now for you who are needy, soul sinful, I cannot make an altar call to have you come up here to the altar as the fashion of the tabernacle is, because there's not even room. There are people that are standing around the walls. There are people that are over the altar share, and it's just a place where we can't do it. But I'm going to pray for you now. And you just submit yourself into Christ just at this hour while I pray. Dear God, we would ask Thy divine mercy upon these waiting, penitent souls who believe that You are and a rewarder of those that diligently seek after Thee. Now I would ask You to be merciful unto them, Lord, and whatever there is, the cancer of doubt, the cancer of temper, the malignancy of unbelief, take it out just now, Lord, and give them the Holy Ghost. Fill their soul with Your goodness. Baptize them into Thy kingdom just now as they have raised their hands in the confession of their faith and asking Thee, O merciful God, to do this for them. For they have changed their thoughts of drifting around on the sea. They want to come into the dock and be hewed out by the Master Builder and made a new creature in Christ Jesus and empowered with His Spirit, governed by His will. So give it to them just now, Father, as we humbly ask in Jesus' name, Thy Son. And now, Lord, there was many hands who went up in the air, or that went up in the air. They realize that they have been from place to place, many of them. They have drove many miles across the states to get to such and such a person that prays for the sick. And they have come maybe a long ways down here. And I do appreciate that, Lord. What if they didn't believe in Me as Your servant? Then they wouldn't come. I thank You for letting them have faith in My prayer. Lord God, I sincerely pray for each one just now, that You, the great God of heavens, will move Your Holy Spirit into their life and will cut off every unbelief. Let them know that it's faith is the victory, not some person of earth, not some church or some certain prayer from some man, which all helps, but faith is the victory. We read of where Thy Son, our Savior, went into His own country, and there were those who said, "Who is this fella? Is not that the carpenter's son? Do we not know him and his mother? And her name is Mary, and here is Jude and Joseph and his sisters." And they were offended at Him. And He marveled at their unbelief and could do no mighty works. We realize no matter how great the person might be favored before You, yet our own faith is the victory.
Amen.
I pray, God, that You'll let man out of this and show Yourself here tonight, where faith is centered on the principles of the resurrection of our Lord. He is not dead, but He is alive forevermore. And He made a promise, "I'll be with you always, even to the end of the world." And we believe that He is here. And we pray, dear God, that tonight that He will show Himself visible, present, and may then the Holy Spirit catch every heart and perform the operation on the faith so that they can overcome their sickness and their afflictions and their diseases. Go out of here with a set faith, no matter if not one thing takes place, yet it'll create a faith that says it's done. That's the victory. It overcomes the world. For we asked it in His name and for His glory. Amen.